recent study, UVA students said, quote, "It's not that typical around here that you go out on a date. You hang out. Like you hang out with your friends, you just visit them at their party." Now, hanging out allows people to get to know members of opposite sex and to enjoy friendships in a non-threatening arena. It's, you know, in many ways a good thing. But it's also the case, too, that hanging out has often sort of no clear gender or sexual relationship norms, and this can lead to confusion. People can be unsure of how to signal their interest in someone in this sort of more ambiguous hanging out pattern. And it can be challenging to transition from hanging out to dating. It's also the case that when you're hanging out with someone, there can be a lack of clarity. So someone may have a romantic interest, the person may not have that same interest, and then ambiguity, of course, can be frustrating for people who are hanging out together. A second model that we see on college campuses is the hooking up model. And so that's not really about how common this is, but I think from what I've seen, between 40 and 64% of college students report at least one hookup over the course of their collegiate career. Sometimes with a friend or sometimes with a relative stranger. At UVA, it might be with someone you've met at the hall, in a league fraternity, or at Trinity or Boyle Heights on a corner. And it's deliberately ambiguous. It can range from anything from kissing to sex. It's usually aided and abetted by alcohol. And of course, it's kept deliberately vague so that both parties can maintain their reputation and can avoid a sense of commitment. Now, in terms of talking about this and describing this, what we see in studies is that about 62% of students would describe as making them feel desirable. So one student said, quote, "We don't go out looking for boyfriends. I would say we go out looking to kiss somebody or dance with somebody to feel sexual. We leave feeling empowered. It's just like being a woman, being sexual more than anything." 64% of students in that same survey also described it though as awkward. And 27% said that it left them feeling empty. So one student said this, quote, "I just don't like encountering that person afterwards, like in a cafeteria or in the library, and just acting like things are normal and cool. It's just very hard to come to grips with that." Okay, so again, there's a way in which a lot of different kinds of feelings are associated with hooking up. And sociologically speaking, it sort of makes sense because it allows students who are kind of navigating an often busy world to have some kind of relationship without being tied down. It also makes sense, too, because a lot of alcohol is flowing freely in the college context. It's congruent with our more erotic popular culture. And it's a clear alternative to being joined at the hip, a pattern I'll talk about in a second. So it's sort of an attractive option for students who have issues around commitment. But again, hooking up doesn't kind of give students a clear path for a relationship future, and it doesn't give them the capacity to enjoy a more committed relationship. By contrast, students who are joined at the hip or who are dating do enjoy a more committed relationship. But in terms of this first pattern being joined at the hip, one UVA student said, quote, "I think relationships tend to move a lot faster because you basically can see the person every day compared to being at home as well. My friends and boyfriends here, they stay over at their boyfriend's house like every night." So just the experience of being on the college campuses, away from the prying eyes of parents, allows some students to have this kind of very intense relationship, this 24/7 relationship, where they are committed. But I think one downside to this from a sociological vantage point is that they're together so much, they don't necessarily have the opportunity to cultivate a more objective view, a more distant view of their partner and their relationship. And the final kind of related pattern is where couples are dating, where they're taking it more slowly, where sex may not be in the picture, or where sex is happening more slowly, and where couples are maintaining friendships with others, and are able, as a consequence of this, to maintain a bit more distance from their partner, a bit more distance from their relationship, and have more perspective on what's happening and where it might be headed. This is also often taking place in the context of sort of thinking about a future that might involve marriage down the road. So the point here is that there are many different types of relationships happening on college campuses, and there is no kind of one clear and compelling model of courtship that would give kids norms, practices, roles, and one end to guide them. So why is this happening on college campuses today? Why is courtship deinstitutionalized? Well, of course, one point to make here is that marriage is really not on the radar screen for most college students. And that's because, in part, they're focusing more on work and education in their early 20s. And so because marriage is really not on their radar screen, they're often, I think, less intentional about the relationships because they don't sort of see them as leading to be more serious. So we can do this in part by looking at trends in age of first marriage, which have shifted from marrying in the early 20s, the 1970s, to marrying typically in the late 20s. It's this slide here tells us. So again, one point to make here in terms of understanding what's happening is that marriage has been pushed down the road, which makes people less serious oftentimes about their relationships in college. A second point to make here, of course, is that the sexual revolution has had a big impact on our culture. By severing the links between sex, marriage, procreation, and love, we've opened up a whole new world. But beyond that kind of, I think, well-known point, we can think about some other discrete factors that are sort of shaping relationships we see on college campuses today. So one is that the college sex ratio on most college campuses favors what would be seen as sort of a classic male sexual strategy of pursuing sex for more physical reasons of conquest. So we see, for instance, that 56% of women at UVA, students at UVA are women, compared to 44% of men. So we have a kind of imbalanced sex ratio at UVA. This is true for most colleges and universities, which again kind of tends to put men more in the driver's seat when it comes to relationships. A second point, of course, is the cultural context is now one where many of adults see premarital sex as acceptable, and in some ways, as importantly, the vast majority of adults don't want to look at anything in such a way as if they should be coming to kind of a moment of judgment about. And so, again, there are not kind of clear norms governing how young adults are approaching sex on college campuses. And then, as I mentioned earlier, from an institutional perspective, we don't have colleges and universities stepping in and acting and looking for to sort of guide and govern what's happening in dorms and other college contexts as it relates to sex. So a third point relates to sort of shifts in gender norms and ideas. And I think we can see how the culture has embraced gender equality, and that's a good thing. But that move has also been kind of linked to this idea that we should view the sexes as basically the same. We've cast aside notions of gender difference. But the feminist Carol Tavris argues that men tend to express affection more through actions and women more through talking. And an older courtship regime built on these differences by requiring men to sort of signal their intentions about a relationship through specific kinds of deeds. And women could then be free to respond to those actions with responses of their own. But in today's world, we don't have kind of clear ideas about gender, clear ideas about what women and men should be doing in this context. Men don't have to signal anything. And many men seem incapable or uninterested in taking the responsibility for the trajectory of their relationships in this new world. So the irony here, in a world that's supposed to be more egalitarian, is that almost all of the burden for defining and managing relationships actually falls upon college women. And then we also, I think, see a great deal of confusion in relationships because people are not sure actually what's happening and where they're headed. Because again, they're not kind of clear gender scripts to guide and govern romantic relationships. And then a fourth point to sort of make it interesting why it is the case that college course has become institutionalized is that many students have experienced divorce. About 30-40% of kids have seen their parents divorce. And these students are more likely to hook up and more likely to have sex in college compared to kids coming from black families. And why is this? Well, obviously there are a lot of things that one could say about this, but I think three factors are particularly salient here. One is that we see that students who come from divorced homes are more likely, paradoxically, to over-idealize relationships and to have kind of unrealistic expectations about relationships. The second point is that they're more likely to have issues around trust and have difficulty trusting others, which affects their relationships. And then the third point that I would make is they're more likely to have weak relationships with their fathers. And that, you know, that experience can make them more vulnerable to entering into a hookup or whatnot. So again, what I'm saying is that college relationships are often characterized by a lack of parity, by a lack of access to a kind of a clear and compelling relationship model. And this means that our students don't have clear norms, clear conventions and roles, governing their relationships. And this in turn, I think, oftentimes is linked to more ambiguity in relationships, more confusion in relationships, more conflict in relationships, and instability, all of which can cause challenges for both women and for men. Okay, so let's think first about women in all of this. So when it comes to women, there are some obvious risks, right? So one obvious physical risk is just pregnancy. And you know, that's, I think, a pretty straightforward risk that I don't need to really unpack. But it's also, I think, important to acknowledge here that today about half of young women will get an STD. And that can be a minor annoyance, but it also can have real implications for, among other things, the capacity to become pregnant. Because many STDs cause problems around this issue of pregnancy later in life. So that's one other physical sort of risk that women are facing when they're sexually active on college campuses. A second set of risks, though, revolve kind of around their social relationships. And we can think, for instance, of the way in which women can lose respect in their own eyes and the eyes of others, for instance, in the wake of a hookup. We can think about how the lack of clarity around relationships can be frustrating for women who think that they're committed to someone, but then find out this person is not committed to them. Because they don't have kind of clear conventions for signaling progression towards a more serious relationship. So just for instance, to give you one example of how this plays out in a sample of college students across the United States. This comes from Paula Englund at NYU. And what she found in her work on contemporary relationships is that there was a kind of, a double standard that still exists when it comes to respect for both men and for women. So, in the wake of a hookup, what she found is that more guys here in sort of reddish purple on the right here versus women in the blue, more guys said they respected someone less because they hooked up with me. So here's sort of the irony, is that the guys were reporting at higher levels in the wake of a hookup, they respected that person less than were the women in the wake of a hookup. And not surprisingly, we also see here that women are reporting, I have had the feeling someone respected me less because I hooked up with them. This is more common for women here on the left than for men on the right. So what I'm saying here again is that this double standard is still, in some ways alive and well on college campuses, and it looks like women pay a higher price in their sense of self and their social standing, looking up than do men. I'm going to kind of turn towards the sort of psychological fallout of collegiate relationships. And what we see is that women face a higher risk of depression and thoughts of suicide in the wake of a hookup or in the wake of multiple relationships with men. So one study found that in a previous year, for those who have hooked up, that more women than men were reporting a negative emotional reaction from that hookup. About 49% of women reported such a reaction compared to 26% of men. So again, what I'm suggesting to you is that maybe a higher emotional cost than we're paying for some aspects of our collegiate relationship culture. And we do see that there's a pretty strong correlation between the number of sexual partners that women have had in the last year and their odds of being depressed, as this slide here suggests on the screen. Now, it's important, kind of, in the spirit of kind of authentic social science, to sort of say this is a correlation. Okay, I can't say as a social scientist that this is kind of definitively about causality. I mean, it could be, in fact, is the case that younger women who are struggling with depression, for instance, are more likely to end up having multiple sexual partners. Well, that's also an interesting thing, you know, that's sort of think about kind of the responsibility then that men who are, you know, engaged in these relationships may have, you know, in some ways, perhaps taking advantage of that to some extent. But what's clear is that there is a relationship here between multiple partnerships and some negative emotional outcomes for younger women. And it's also the case, too, that other work that's been done actually on younger girls and adolescents in high school suggests that even controlling for pre-existing risks of depression, that girls who had multiple relationships in high school are more likely to experience emotional distress. So that's the better answer than the causal story. But there's clearly something going on here that's worth thinking about and worth attending to in the psychological domain. Now, when it comes to men, we did see, of course, two slides ago, that a minority of men do experience a kind of negative reaction hooking up. So there is, you know, some portion of men who are affected by hookups. We also see, too, this idea, you know, that the guys who are kind of known as players may also be paying a price. From work of economist Joe Sabia, who finds the guys who were sexually active kind of, you know, across the field, so to speak, were often doing worse in their academic work. And in his formulation, pleasures of sex, quote, may induce boys to choose meat investments in sex over schooling. It's also, I think, kind of doing this idea that maybe it's a sort of focus for some guys on kind of status associated with, you know, with their sexual activity. That, again, may distract them from focusing on their schooling. But the other point I want to make, too, again, about, you know, men, is that, and, you know, I went to UVA from 1988 to 1992, so, you know, more than 20 years ago. And some of this was, of course, happening at that point in time as well. But I think that today in college campuses, sort of the fallout of all this has become, you know, more salient and in some ways more consequential. And that's why we are, I think, seeing, you know, my sense is more men being tried, expelled, or shamed by sexual assaults trials on their college campuses. In other words, I think there's something about what's happening in college campuses and relationship culture that is, you know, a bit more toxic. And sort of one consequence of all this is, again, it's that more of these relationships are kind of landing either in a local court or in a college judicial court. Now, some of these cases involve, you know, clear violence on the part of God. And he's clearly engaged in profoundly bad behavior. But it's also the case that we have more and more cases where there is a lot of ambiguity in the situation, and where it's not exactly clear that he's engaged in either illegal behavior or in behavior that would be in contradiction to a campus judicial code. So just kind of give you one example of how this has played out at somewhere else, not at UVA, at Columbia, in a fairly famous case, been sort of described as some sort of an actress case. Because the woman who was involved in this took to carrying a mattress around Columbia in protest over the way in which all this played out from her perspective at Columbia. So we have the case of Paul Nungesser, who met Emma Salkowitz at Columbia University, and they both served as orientation leaders together 1 year. and their joint service initially led to a kind of platonic friendship. But this friendship turned sexual briefly in the spring of 2012, although it was sexual without kind of clearly developing into a boyfriend-girlfriend relationship. They were sort of on again, off again as friends and whatnot in the spring of 2012. But then at the end of the summer, in August of 2012, they again had sex. They had a number of sexual encounters in the fall of 2012. Indeed, on October 3rd, on Sokolos' birthday, Mungesser sent her an effusive greeting. And she responded the next morning with, quote, "I love you, Paul. Where are you?" This is like, I mean, by text. She had big question marks, exclamation marks. And he had saved these in text, or he got them through access from his phone company. By the spring of 2013, so about 6 months later, things took a very different turn. Sokolowitz alleged that their August 2012 encounter had constituted a violent sexual assault on Mungesser's part. Now, I cannot adjudicate what happened between the two of them in August, or before then or after then. But among other things, what's striking about what came to be known as the Columbia Mattress case is how much ambiguity reigned in the relationship prior to her filing these dramatic charges against Mungesser. So again, they were friends, they were more than friends, they were friends, they were more than friends. And if you look at the texts which were, released through part of the lawsuit and something else, there's just a lot of stuff happening between them. But they were never kind of clearly boyfriend and girlfriend either. So it just, it was, I think, probably quite confusing for everyone in some way. But this led to a very public, assault charge, which University ended up not falling through on, and then she took up this mattress and sort of walked around Columbia for the rest of her Columbia career, protesting what she saw as an injustice in Columbia. So I think for many students, and particularly for men, all this ambiguity, all of this sort of the lack of a clear mutual commitment governing intimate sexual relationships, can end up for a judicial body or on college campuses, which of course is also quite difficult. So again, what I'm saying here in terms of the bottom line is that the ambiguity, the confusion, the conflict, and instability associated with collegiate relationships can be associated for some women with increasing sense of shame or depression, and for some men with increasing risk of becoming distracted from their studies or ending up in some kind of court. Okay, so I've kind of painted a sobering portrait of college relationships and men relationships more generally. And again, what I'm stressing to you tonight is I think that our universities, our colleges, our churches, and the broader society have largely abandoned the task of organizing courtship. And that's left many of your younger adults clueless, confused, and sometimes conflicted. And despite all this, what's interesting to me as a professor at UVA is that when I ask my students questions about kind of how they would like things to be, and have this thing called the clicker, which allows me to sort of ask them questions on an anonymous basis. So they can kind of click option A, B, and C on the screen, and I can get a sense of their views about matters without them personally raising their hand about things. But when I ask them about this issue of courtship, a clear majority of my students in a large survey of courses indicate they would like to have a clear courtship model accessible to them at UVA. We kind of give them a sense of how do we go on dates, how do we how to progress in our relationships, how do we know how we're getting serious and we're both on the same page, etc. So given this, I've developed a number of rules for contemporary courtship. It really actually applies to younger adults more generally. Now, I'm not going to go through every rule, every do and every don't tonight, but I want to give you just a few rules from this list that I think are instructive that we can share with younger adults as they kind of make their way through relationships as young men and young women. So the first thing that I ask my students at UVA is this question. Would you want to do something that would increase your risk of divorce, conflict, and marital happiness? And of course, no one raises their hand for that, that question. Of course, what they don't often realize, most of them realize, is that cohabitation is associated with an increased risk of divorce, having less commitment in your marriage, having more conflict in your marriage, and being less happy in marriage. It's a surprise to most students this is the case. Now, it's also true, again, in the spirit of being an honest social scientist, that the link between cohabitation and divorce empirically now is weaker, and there are questions about whether or not it's, again, causally related to divorce, for instance. But what's also true, based upon some work of Scott Stanley, a psychologist at the University of Denver, is that cohabitation prior to an engagement is still clearly linked to worse outcomes for married couples, both in terms of the stability of relationships and the quality of relationships. And his point is that a lot of younger adults today are sliding through major transitions in their relationships. They're sliding into them without kind of mutually deciding to go through these transitions. And cohabitation is one example of that. So what he's talking about is that, you know, a couple might meet at a party on a Saturday night and get together a little bit, might spend weekends together for a period of time, then a few nights a week for a period of time, and then kind of slide into full-time cohabitation. But ever having a serious conversation about their values, their hobbies, their future life plans, how they want to handle, you know, any number of things. And so they're really not necessarily on the same page, and this initial slide might be followed by other slides. They might slide into having a puppy together, you know, buying a TV together, maybe even buying, nowadays, a condo together. And what his work suggests is that when you kind of slide through these major transitions, you often don't have the kind of friendship and mutual commitment that are really important for a successful marriage down the road. So he has found with his colleague, Elena Rhodes, for instance, looking at a sample of younger adults over a number of years who transition from being unmarried to being married, that those couples who begin their relationship by living together without a specific commitment to marry, but as well as either being engaged or married, were more likely to have lower levels of marital quality. Okay, so what that means specifically here is that on this slide, in a sense, these couples kind of slid into cohabitation here on the right. Okay, so they moved in together before an engagement or before they were married. And these couples did not live together until either after they were engaged or after they were married. And these couples over here, who kind of made this transition after kind of mutually talking about it, making the decision to be together, are more likely to be happier in marriages on the left here for those on the right who kind of slid into cohabitation. So again, just think about this idea of sliding versus deciding in relationships, and understand here the couples who, and this applies, of course, not just at this point, but sort of across the life course for us folks who are middle-aged married couples as well. And when you are kind of deciding as a couple to do something big together, it's much more fruitful. You're just kind of sliding into a big transition in your life. Okay, so that's one point. A second point is about sort of multiple partnerships. And, you know, I think there's some idea that, you know, the more experience you have, you know, of something, the more likely you are to succeed. So if you have experience as a teacher, you know, you've taught hundreds of classes, you're probably a bit more successful than if you have had, you know, no experience teaching. Or, you know, if you're a soccer player or a tennis player, you know, the more experience that you get, typically the more success that you experience. Well, that principle, that pattern is not true for relationships. What we see is that people who have multiple partnerships prior to marriage typically experience less stability in marriages and less happiness. And this slide here gives you some idea about divorce. And this slide here gives you a sense of marital happiness for women. So women who've had more partners prior to marriage are less likely to report higher quality marriages after the wedding. Okay, so again, more experience when it comes to relationships does not equal better marriages down the road. So what's happening here, and frankly, I'm hypothesizing, because we don't have a clear explanation, just notice this pattern. But I think one thing could be emotional baggage. So you've had a lot of relationships prior to letting it in, like make you a little bit more jaundiced about your view of love and marriage in particular. That's like one possibility. A second possibility is we are creatures of habit. And so if you've been in a habit of, you know, breaking up seriously for having it, or break up habits sort of to you, you might be more inclined in the face of your first serious marital difficulty to head for the exits, because that's what you've experienced in a number of occasions before. Or a third possibility that was raised by Bain and Rhodes, one of the scholars in this work, is that if you had lots of relationships prior to your marriage, you'd be kind of comparing your spouse, say your husband, you know, to boyfriend A, who was quite handsome, to boyfriend B, who was quite funny, to boyfriend C, who was quite ambitious. So kind of you might be more inclined to compare your husband, who isn't necessarily as ideal in all three of those outcomes, to the three different guys in ways that, you know, might make you discount your husband, for instance. Okay, on a more sort of positive note, another thing that comes out from this research is that we should think about encouraging your adults to take it slow. This comes from some work done by, for instance, Sharon Sasser at Cornell. She finds that couples who are moving quickly into sex and cohabitation may not have the opportunity to establish a strong foundation of communication, of trust, and therefore emotional security in the relationship. So again, the point here simply is that when you're moving more slowly and getting to know the person, you find out if you're compatible, you establish a measure of trust, and growing communication, all in ways that will facilitate a stronger romantic attachment. And we see in empirical research that, again, couples who began their relationship by not taking it slowly, by hooking up, were less likely to experience high quality relationship compared to couples who did not begin their relationship with a hookup. So that's sort of one piece of evidence on this score. And then some different research from Jason Carroll has found the couples who waited to have sex in their relationship enjoyed more satisfaction in the relationship, enjoyed better communication in the relationship, enjoyed better sexual quality in the relationship, and enjoyed more stability in the relationship. So again, kind of putting sex off to some extent here was linked to better relationship outcomes. A fourth point is this idea of chemistry. And when I was a student at UVA, living on the lawn in my fourth year, I knew the head of the College Republicans and the editor of what was then the Alternative Weekly at UVA. And these were both very attractive people. And they, you know, got together romantically, I think in the spring of my fourth year at UVA. And there was, you know, there was a powerful attraction there between these two people.